it and I'll pass the control over to you.
All right. Okay.
Oh, really? Because still.
Yeah, but the next thing I can do.
For the first piece, it's going to be like coming down.
Yes.
With the laptop.
I got lost.
Oh.
Yeah. So what's happening is every time I'm putting a laptop, it adjusts this thing.
Okay, you just stay here. You just stay. All right. Thank you.
All right, we are starting soon. Welcome to sit down. All right, I hope you have enough to eat. And now, let's come back to the program proper. Okay, the next speaker is Pratipa Jagnari. She is a senior Python developer with the company, looking over the development and maintenance of backend, including APIs and applications-oriented depth of work. In this talk, she is going to share with us how they transform their Django implementations to use Celery for asynchronous work, as well as how they handle the memory leak in the setup. The thing about asynchronous tasks is that the hard part is not how to run them, but what to do when things fail due to shortage of memory. Yeah, I heard some people did sound something that like, you know, to your heart. Yeah. All right. Okay. I'll just pass the control to the speaker. What is yours?
Thank you. Hi everyone. I'm Pratibha. Good afternoon. How many of you do identify this background image? Great. Sorry? You were saying something? Yes, it is from London, but it is from not movie, Sherlock BBC. But yeah. So this is the Sherlock BBC. So this is kind of the vantage viewpoint which Sherlock used to see the complete London for the, you know, eagle eye view. It's the theme of my talk as well, because when we lose track of small things, we have to go up and see the eagle eye view of our whole project. And end of the day, every developer becomes Sherlock Holmes for their code at some point of time. So let's get started with this one. This is about myself. I'm Pratibha. I'm self-employed Python developer. I do freelancing work. And I've been with Python from last 10 years and freelancing from past 3 years. Before that, I was working with Symantec and other IBM companies. So being a freelancer, I think this could stand very firm that it's my job to know what my clients don't know, but they do need it later point of time. So this is our agenda. We'll be going over with my setup, then how we get into figuring out the common patterns, how we figure out how can be the solution help us, and then we will look into those few commands which help me in debugging the processes. So how many of you use Celery? Great. So you will identify this as the normal basic syntax of command which we use, Celery followed by the project and the worker and how much restriction you want to put on the workers and the logging levels, of course. In my setting, we were using the same one, and along with the limiting the task time each worker can spend. Along with that, my salary was 4.1.0 to be exact, with CentOS for the security purpose, and my broker was RabbitMQ. This is the basic structure, a basic flow, how we use Celery with our Django application. Django has some asynchronous tasks and some synchronous tasks. So for async task, it hand over to Rabbit or Redis, whichever broker you want to use. And for synchronous, it directly use database connections. So Celery have a main process that take tasks from the queues of Redis or Rabbit, and then it have multiple workers that kind of feed data into the database. This thing we were using for writing the database. Our application is heavily write oriented. We have to update the timestamps of connected devices for every 5 seconds for around 2000 devices, which has each 5 devices connected. So it was every 5 seconds around 10,000 writes almost. Given this, we have to implement Celery because it was taking more and more time to respond in the API, and we have to make that API as fast as possible. So after doing the basing checkup on the payload, we just put the payload into the Celery, and Celery will take care of that, and we will respond for the main API that the data has been put in queue. So that's how we rely on Celery for our heavy lifting task. So in our setup, we figured out that there are some point after which Celery processors are consuming more and more memory. And the only solution for that we figure out that we have to restart the whole Celery processors, not only the workers. And it was getting more and more tedious because the load was increasing and we cannot start Celery every time. So after doing the initial checkup, we figured out that if we monitor the memory usage, it was linear. So this is how actually it was happening. This is our task queue. We were putting the data payloads in the task queue. This each element, 2, 3, 4, 2, this is the size of payload, 2 MB, 3 MB, 4 MB, like this. We had the main Celery process that was consuming each task item. It was consuming and then forking the workers. Now we kept the track of memory, free memory size. So this is just for example purpose. Let's say we have 100 MB of memory free. The main process, the consumption of main process was zero, and there was no workers at that time. Then main process forked one process, that will be your fork pool worker, and it consumed 2 MB. So the size become 96 MB free, 2 MB for main process and 2 MB for workers. Then the next process forked for 3 MB of payload. So the free memory become 90 MB and main process 5 and workers 5. But then there was a catch. When one process is done, one forked pool worker was done with this process, it returned and all of its memory got freed. But the 2 MB which was added to main Celery, it stayed. Okay, and that was causing the problem. Linearly, we figured when task payload was processed, it goes on and on. 4 MB got assigned to main process and to worker, But when 3 MB was gone, it stayed with the main process. And linearly, it was increasing like this. And after some time, the production was down. It was so small that it took us around 3 days to figure this out because the payload size was very less. So our initial analysis told us that the RAM consumption is increasing linearly, and that in the main celery process, and that leads to our consumption of 100% RAM usage. Along with that, we figured that there are some processors which are consuming CPUs very much, and that leads to 100% consumption of CPU as well later. And then our production went down. And we couldn't do anything about it because we were new to celery. This was our second setup where we have used celery. But as every developer is Sherlock, the game was on with celery. So we analyzed the common pattern. First, we did the stress testing of celery. There was no leaking of memory in that. Then we figured out, but celery with Django code is leaking. Then we run our code synchronously and figured that no, there's no leaking in our code. If it was leaking in our code, that means the direct running of that code should also at some point of time will lead to 100% RAM usage. It didn't. Also, the memory leaking was with parent process only, not with the fork processors, the fork workers. Then we figured out there are some orphan child processors which were workers which were still running, and they were not killed from the parent processors, and we did not know why. And there are moments where the workers, but still the tasks were in the queue. So overall and all, we figured out that maybe everything was pointing to main process. It was the task of main process to kill the orphan child. It didn't. It was the task of main process to assign the task as soon as worker get freed. It didn't. So everything was pointing and everything was telling the obvious fact is the issue is with main celery process and all the folk workers are fine. But the thing with obvious facts are that they are very deceiving, because we figured out that not only the main processors but workers are also the culprits. Then we have to dig into the celery code. We have to figure out where actually the celery causing problem and why. Because at other places, wherever I go and tell that I have a celery problem, whether it be ISA or the issue tracking, they said that we are quite happy with celery and none of them were having this problem. Then after too much digging into their issues, I figured a long back issue of similar explanation. They were also facing the memory leak, that too in the celery 3, but they didn't fix it till now, till last April, because they didn't know where to look into it. Then me and one other guy, which is also senior Python developer in some other firm, we both were facing this issue. And we figured there is something called event dispatcher in celery. What it do, there are channels called combo channels. There's a library combo which it use, and event dispatcher dispatch the events to combo channels, and from there they pick it. Can you excuse me for a minute? Sorry. Thank you. So then we figured out that there's a point where there's a connection issue with RabbitMQ, but still event dispatcher is buffering the input events. When it is not able to communicate with RabbitMQ, it should stop it. It should not buffer, but even then it was buffering, and that leads to the memory. That was the main reason of memory leak. So how to solve this? We suggested to turn off the event dispatcher in the case there is a connection issue with Rabbit, and that leads to a single line of code change. Single line of code change resolving the memory issue. It took us 3 weeks to figure this out. So in the code you can see that we have put a flag which will stop buffering if your event consumer is offline. That's all it takes to actually figure out how it happens. But even then we had other problems to take care of, because there were orphan processes, there were tasks in queue, still that was not done. This was just one piece of multiple issues. So this is what was suggested, and hopefully it will be there in Celery 4.4, but it is not there currently. But it is there in the branch. So if any of you feel that you're facing similar issue, you can put this code directly in your Celery implementation. So we raised the change request to stop buffering events when offline, but this only deals with the memory leakage. We have other problems as well. We figured that there are some processes which are consuming too much RAM even for a smaller payload. That means either there is something too much to data to write in database, which was not there. Data was not too much in database as well, so that it will take so much time, but still the RAM usage was very high. So we found there are some orphan children running, which should have been killed by the main process. Then we dig more and figured that we are using Supervisor to run our Celery. And in that, Celery process parents don't propagate the stop signal to its child processes. That was the problem we faced. And that what left them orphan. And obviously PS helped a lot in debugging this one. But then we put stop as a group, so that if we set this flag true in supervisor D, it sends the stop signal to the whole process. One second. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Then we were using max memory per child. That means each worker can consume a certain amount of memory to execute the task it is working on. But the problem was that sometimes the payload was more than the memory we have assigned, and it was restarting the worker process without completing it, and hence we were losing the data. We were losing the timestamps, which was very critical for us. So then we dug into the Celery and we figured out that there's a flag called max task per child. That is, this is the amount of task which each worker has to perform before it terminates. And obviously we cannot figure out directly what value can be fined for max task per child, because it changes with the hardware architecture. With the lower configuration this number is less, with higher configuration the number you can put as high. So this helps us in handling the high CPU usage as well. Okay. Then I had a flag in my Django settings, which was to limit the time for which a task can run. But if the payload is huge, it takes more than the assigned time and it was killing the worker. I didn't put the hard or soft limit, there was just one limit. And due to that also, I was losing. It does help, but it didn't help a lot. So this setting I have removed from my settings, and it helped me in reducing the CPU percentage to a lot less than it was earlier. I'm sorry, this is not my laptop, it's taking some time. Yep. So as a database backend, how many of you are using Postgres with Celery? Great. So if you have faced similar issue over there, this issue was with Pygress library for 2.5, but 2.6.1 onwards it is fixed. We were facing that Postgres unload the callback after closing its connection, but other SSL consumers were not able to release the lock. That leads us to a lot of problem because there was a deadlock. And even if it is allowing a thread to deadlock itself, if it is trying to reacquire its lock. So the older library was one of the culprits in our setup. Now there was one thing that task was paying you even when there were free workers. So after putting the task with heavy payloads, we know that every worker should be working rigorously, but still there were free workers but no payloads were getting executed. So we figured out what can be the issue, and that happens that it is because Celery use a flag in which when a worker is assigned a task, it will first mark the task as completed, and then it was working on that task. But we didn't know that it is working on that task. That was also creating problem for us, because of any of the previous reasons, like either the time limit or the memory limit, if worker crash, we lose the data. So we have to use this flag get used into the Django code, where you use the decorator of shared task. There you use this flag as true, and it force worker to first complete the work and then mark work as done, so that if it crash, the work is still in the queue and it can be picked up by some other worker. So there are default numbers, suppose let's say n. So each worker can reserve n number of tasks on its name and then start working on that. Okay, thank you. So each worker can reserve certain number of tasks on its name, then start working on them. Again, point of losing the data. So this is the flag prefetch multiplier. It means user can assign only one task on its name, and after finishing that only, it can start working on the next one. Because Celery is a environment where multiprocessing can happen and every worker have its own queue, if you don't want to lose data, it's better to assign only one task to each worker. So these are the points which helped me in figuring out how actually Celery behave and how we can dig more into the Celery code, because we were new to Celery and these flags are somewhere kind of hidden and they were not clear to us how to use them. So while writing the task for the Celery, we figured out that we have to write as much RSF safe task as possible, and we should put some method to write them in a way that acknowledge that means if there is an error, there should be a reporting mechanism. You should write your tasks so that they are self-contained. Then there is a tool called Flower, if you have heard of it. It's a web-based tool. Celery can be single node and it can have multiple nodes where you can be running the asynchronous task using it. So you can use Flower to monitor it. It's a web-based tool for monitoring and administering salary workers. You can see which processes are working on what is causing the bottleneck, which is taking more time. That's how it is really helpful to us. Then we have to have some open mind that asynchronous tasks are hard to debug because we don't know what's going inside unless you have too much logging in place. And it's better to use get task logger flag because it automatically tells you the task name and the unique ID as a part of logs when you put the logging. Plus, next time when you update the salary, obviously it's advisable, but people sometimes don't do for the minor patches. You should test the libraries in your test environment first before applying them to production. It's true, for very minor patches, people tend to go directly to the production, but great developers make mistakes too, and this happens with salary as well. These are the useful commands which helped me a lot in debugging the salary because it tells me how much exploratory can be the PS command and how much we can get data from PS. It helps me in salary commands as well, like you can see the inspect active command and strace, which was telling me what's going inside the processes or the workers which are hung. We cannot do much into that in the logging, but this helps a lot. Where are they stuck? These are really useful commands. So the first link is the link of GitHub issue that we raised, or you can say the old issue which we continued to debug. And it has the latest update on when is that change is going to be there. It was, I think somewhere in May, they incorporate that commit into their main branch. So if you have similar issue, you can find it here, the solution. And the other links are the best practices for the salary, from where I get the information about the flags and the parameters which I'm using. So that's it from my side. And this stands true for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we have time for some questions. Anybody have anything?
So, thanks for sharing. I really enjoyed listening to the troubleshooting process and also the solution to group. I was wondering how much logging did supervisor B gives you, because you said that sometimes they will still because supervisor B is like that was exceeding the memory limit.
Supervisor D flag we used because there were orphaned processes. That means they have done with their work, but they were still hanging around. So when we were running salary from the supervisor D, it was not, main process was not sending the signal to kill the worker process. That was happening. So we put this flag over there, which is true. So it will actively send the signal that if your work is done, so main process will kill it. That's what it was helping. I think your question is about how we figured out if a worker process is hung and where it is blocked.
Yeah, something like that. Like, I'm wondering whether there were locks that were useful.
Actually, there were two places which was helpful to me. One was obviously logging. I was using the Python logging module. When we ran into the issue, we were logging each and every transaction which we were making to database. That was helpful, but obviously too much logging was that. Then Flower was helpful in figuring out where the bottlenecks are. You should really check out if you're monitoring salary and if you have salary running in the multi-node environment. Thirdly, the strace with the hanged worker ID, that really helps in figuring out what at which point it is there, because obviously using the PID we can kill them. But where is it actually stuck? That was our goal of root cause analysis. So these three things actually helps a lot. But for the memory leaking, the event dispatcher one, that was more of trial and error. We were debugging, we were figuring out at each point. Then when we stopped RabbitMQ when Celery was running, it happened at that time. We figured that oh, it is still trying to gather the task, or it is still trying to buffer the events even when there is no connection with RabbitMQ. That's how it was piling up the useless memory, hence the flag.
Did you figure out why the connection to RabbitMQ went down?
It can be many reasons. For us, we deliberately stopped it to test. Like I said, it was trial and error. We were trying everything that we can, stop this, stop that. But when we stopped RabbitMQ, so there's one thing. If you're using the older version of RabbitMQ, that do have connection issue. I think libRabbitMQ 101 onwards is very stable. The older versions are having this connectivity issue every now and then. Same goes with Redis. Many people suggest to use RabbitMQ over Redis for this. Anyone? Sorry?
What are you using for the testing and load testing?
For unit testing, normal Django test cases. For load testing, we do Locust. PyTest, we do when there are UI involved. Okay, ours is basically API-oriented architecture because there are multiple devices. So I'm working on the backend of front-end is the IoT device. So it is more an API-oriented architecture because of that. Okay. Yeah. Thanks to Sherlock. I love that debugging.
So I just want to know about the connectivity. What you can do is there are some
run settings that you can change to make the connection, then can see the loud connection.
Actually, your mic went down. Okay, I'll give mine.
Some kernel settings for the TCP connections and then the TCP
connections will be more stable.
This is what
fixes
for me.
Oh, for Celery.
For RabbitMQ and Celery.
For RabbitMQ and Celery. Okay, great.
The problem that sometimes Celery would use the connection to RabbitMQ, but when you make, I mean, the settings are documented.
Okay.
Then
great.
The connections will be a little longer and Celery
okay.
doesn't have to work as hard.
Okay.
Internet.
That's great.
And then one more thing about this. It's because you mentioned that you were losing data when the task failed.
Yes.
So if you know some options that the task is put back in the queue when it fails, so you don't lose the data.
That's what the flag. The flag. Thank you. Yes.
When you use Celery, do you have a situation there where you need a fresh division of the job among multiple users?
Sorry?
Unless you have multiple users, like user A is adding 1,000 tasks to the queue, right?
Okay.
And user B coming adding one task to the queue.
Okay.
Means that user B has to wait for user A to finish rather than user A starting immediately.
So in our setup, it is single Django application which is making the entry for all the front-end users. Because it's API-oriented, we don't distinguish the payload based on users. Whatever payload come, it goes in. But higher priority, like there are some APIs whose data should go in database on urgent basis, then we maintain a separate queue, the priority queue.
The priority queue, you have to pre-create the queue first, right? You can't define the queue on the fly, right?
You can create two queues or multiple queues in Celery. And you can assign names to them, And when you put data into the celery queue, you can tell which queue you want to put. And you can assign the priorities. Because this will happen as well when you have a payload of 100 MB and there is a payload of 2 MB. So you can segregate the payloads, 10 MB should, below 10 MB should go here, above 10 MB should go here, like this. So they will get assigned to different workers and they get executed. They don't have to, the smaller task doesn't have to wait for the longer task, bigger task.
Okay, I think we'll just take one last question with Darren.
So following up with the question of testing, so you mentioned that you ran the stress test but you couldn't reproduce the issue, was it?
The stress testing of celery, it is separate.
Okay. So
it is what they provide if you want to stress test. That is what they use to say that celery can execute 1 million things, 1 million tasks per second.
Okay, I had the impression that you were
No. Because, see, what they claim is 100 million tasks per second, but that can be just printing what is the input, right? But when it comes to database transaction, it's more time consuming.
Okay.
So that takes more time. That's it? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.